So hey, my name is Robin. I'm here with Said Hassan from Gaza Sky Geeks, the first accelerator ever to come out of Gaza. And my name is Robin Wauters. I'm the founding editor of Tech.eu, and we're here at the Tech Open Air Festival in Berlin, edition 2015. So Said, welcome to Berlin. Is this your first time in Berlin?
It's my first time in Europe.
In Europe?
Yeah.
Wow. Awesome. How are you enjoying it?
It's cool. It's good. A lot of walking, but it's good.
I can imagine. So Gaza Sky Geeks, what is it?
Gaza Sky Geeks is the first accelerator in Gaza, and it's the only one. It started by a generous fund from Google as a tech hub, and in 2011. In late 2013, we decided to make it a business accelerator. And in 2014, we've made our first three-year investment in Gaza. And now in 2015, we're incubating 20 startups who are pitching their startups today to investors.
Nice. Just out of curiosity, how many people are in Gaza?
Gaza population is around 1.8 million.
Okay. And how many startups would you estimate are operational in Gaza?
The startup scene is young and starting in Gaza. We have many startups, around 40 or 50 startups, who are trying to operate from different parts of Gaza, because we have university incubators. But for real startups, we're around 20, 50 startups.
And what are the typical activities of startups coming out of Gaza? Is it fintech? Is it enterprise tech? Is it consumer focused? What kind of companies come out of there?
Well, as Gaza starts to have a startup scene, we're more generic until we find like our interest or our focus. So we started last year, so it's still very early to speak about a focus of Gaza.
Sure. Were you looking at the success of the accelerators in other countries, US and Europe, and decided to follow that model? Or was it really a conscious decision that that was what the ecosystem needed?
Sure.
How did that work?
First of all, the whole thing about startups started with the whole development of the world and the trend of the startups and entrepreneurship, and then the Arabic world started to be the untapped market. We have 22 countries or more who speak the same language, who need a lot of services, who have needs for a lot of stuff. And it needed to have some people to serve that needs. So startup scenes started in Egypt and Tunisia and Saudi Arabia, everywhere, to satisfy the needs of the Arabic customers. And Gaza was a part of that region. And it was a good part because it has a highly educated population with less demand of money because they can operate on less. So it was logical to have like a startup from Gaza who tries to serve the Arab world. And of course, the whole startup scene started by looking at the world, like Europe and the US, and how startups are helping the economy.
So obviously, it's a very young ecosystem, but typically when you have accelerators, it's usually meant to kickstart businesses, but then at a given point they need to mature, they need follow-on funding. Do you have any VC funds or angel investors in Gaza?
Gaza is a part of the Palestinian territories, which is the West Bank and Gaza. And in the West Bank, we've got a follow-on investment and a Series A investment and a Series B investment already. So we think the VCs are there. We have one Palestinian VC called Sadara Ventures, who invested about $1 million in a company called Yamsafer, and $3 million in a company called WebTop. And we have new emerging VCs, and we have VCs from the region. So the money, the finance is becoming to be like easy to find, but we're trying to develop our startups to reach the stage where they can seek that funding.
All right. Typically, accelerators, what differentiates, I think, a good accelerator from a bad one is the mentorship that you can provide, more tapping into the wider network and not just the people running the accelerator. But how hard is it to build a mentorship network or a network of mentors out of Gaza?
Well, as Gaza Sky Geeks, one of our main focuses, unlike other accelerators like who seek funding at the beginning, we seek mentorship because we are in a closed community and we don't have exposure to other markets. So we're always trying to bring regional and global mentors into Gaza via Skype or physically, because we're a part of Mercy Corps and we can get people in and out of Gaza. And last year we've brought 10 international mentors, Googlers, people who work in the tech field, incubators and accelerators from the Silicon Valley and from the region into Gaza to meet with our startups and to teach them. And we usually have like a connection with a lot of mentors, and due to our active social media presence, we have a lot of people interested in helping our startups.
Interesting. So you mentioned that you are part of Mercy Corp, which makes it easier for international people to come into Gaza. How does it actually work? Like, why is it so complicated?
First, it's hard to get out of Gaza or get in of Gaza because of the whole political scene. But as a humanitarian agency, we can facilitate in getting people the permits and to get in and out and having them secured in Gaza.
Got it. What's Google's involvement exactly?
Google started the whole thing. It funded the first tech hub in 2011. And Google now still funds some of our programs. Like, we have a program that is dedicated for women entrepreneurs. The first round was funded by Google. And we have a lot of cooperation with Google. We're part of the Google for Entrepreneurship Network.
Now, I know you're not a political analyst and you prefer to talk about business, but I have to ask, like, how does the geopolitical situation affect, you know, running an accelerator out of Gaza? Because even the thought itself is kind of strange.
We're a part of Gaza, as the rest of Gazans, and we face the same problem as a business accelerator. We have the electricity problem. We don't have electricity all the time. We have the permits. We can get out or in. And we have the conflicts that happens every time and then, and bombing and everything. So we face a lot of difficulties, but I think from that difficulties, Gazans are resilient and determined to create a new beginnings, which and a new future for them, which is the passion and the first beginning of creating a good entrepreneur. It's the drive. And a lot of Gazans are hoping to create a new future for them and for their kids.
Obviously, you're very early in the process. You've only done one batch or one program so far, but what are some of the things that you've personally learned so far?
We've learned that exposure is a huge thing. Getting a lot of people inside of Gaza and getting them to meet our startups can help us a lot to create new businesses. We've learned that, for example, it's more of a technical stuff that we've learned about, like, we've expanded our work time because of the electricity thing. We start at 8 and we close at 8, so we operate 12 hours to provide people with electricity. So we have a lot of stuff that we've learned from our first batch, and we're trying to develop our programs every year, and we're trying to connect with other accelerators from around the world to give us, like, knowledge and experience to how to run an accelerator in a good way.
So what are the chances of a really big startup or a really big tech company kind of coming out of Gaza in the next, say, 5 years?
I think in 5 years we can have like one or two companies come out of Gaza who can serve the Arab region. Because in West Bank, which is the other part of our country, we've had companies who were able to succeeded in growing their companies. Like, we have the hotels.com for the Middle East, which it's called the Msafer. And we have the biggest medical porter for the Middle East, Wabtab, and those are coming from also Palestinians, but living in the West Bank. So I think it's there is an opportunity, there is an untapped market, and there is always a chance for Gazans to create the next big thing in the Arab region.
Are you getting a lot of media attention?
Sure, we've been featured in most of the global publications, Forbes, Wired, TechCrunch, and everything. And locally, we've been also getting a lot of media attention because of being the accelerator and the only one in Gaza, and having that story that there is another side of Gaza, which is bright, which is people who are trying to do stuff, is always good to hear.
It's a great story. So aside from electricity, how's the internet connection in Gaza?
We don't have 3G networks. We only operate in 2G network. So for the companies that are trying to create solutions with mobility, and for example, we have a company that tries to do Uber for the Middle East, and they can imagine how to use a mobile with a 3G network. We only have two Wi-Fi. But we have a good infrastructure for ADSL, which is the landline, And but we don't have like the mobile internet connectivity all the time.
Interesting. Well, Said, thank you very much for the explanation,
thank
and best
you.
Of luck.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.